you saw my recent art haul video, then you saw that I finally got some of the Derwent Watercolour pencils. I am stoked about these. I've been wanting them forever. So I decided that it is finally time to try them out, and I will let you know what I think of them. Hi, Shanna Rowe Jackson here from Caution Arts That Play, and today I am finally trying out my Derwent watercolor pencils. If you saw my art haul video a while back, then you have seen that I got these quite a while ago, but I didn't really have the chance to try them out, so I am finally getting around to it. So a little bit about the piece that I am working on. This is something that I had actually sketched out, I think, last fall when I was in a printmaking class. And I never really did get around to using this for printmaking. It was just way too detailed to have to do the intaglio print with. So I kept the drawing because I always thought it was fun and I always planned on finishing it in an illustrative style. And originally, I think I had planned to use ink tents for it, but I thought that this would be a great piece to try out my watercolor pencils on. So that's what I'm doing now. And I just laid in the sky and I was not being careful to get a perfect gradient in that sky because I kind of wanted it to be cloudy. And so I did a lot of scribbling, and as you can see, it really didn't matter. It's not like regular colored pencils. It did not matter that I was doing so much scribbling because when I put the water to it, it smoothed out pretty well. And this piece I thought would be fun to do. There's like a lot of fun details in this and a lot of whimsical things. I thought it would be fun to do because it has a mermaid in it and it's May. And a lot of people are doing the mermaid challenge right now where you draw a mermaid a day. I'm not participating in that because I didn't even hear of mermaid till we were already a couple days into May, which is funny because you'd think I would have heard of it last year or whenever it had started, but I had never heard of it before, and I love mermaids, so I think maybe next year I might participate, but it really just depends on what I have for time. And right now, I just don't have the time to devote to a challenge like that, but I think it's great that other people are doing it. So this will probably be my only mermaid contribution to mermaid, but I still think it's a lot of fun. And I was really liking these pencils. This is actually quite a small drawing. It's only an 8x10, and one of the things that I really wanted to test out was to see how much fine detail I could do with these, which is the advantage of having a pencil. And I could really get in there with a nice sharp tip to get the details I wanted, because I have a lot of small things like small butterflies and dragonflies and things like that in this drawing. The paper that I am using is the Canson XL mixed media paper. It's in one of their blue spiral bound sketchbooks, and I did not originally plan on using this paper, but it worked surprisingly well. Originally, I was going to transfer this line drawing to a heavier weight paper, but I tried three different papers and none of them seemed to work well. They didn't seem to keep the saturation as well as this paper. So this is a thinner paper than I would have liked, but it really held the color a lot better. I had originally tried the Strathmore Mixed Media 400 series, which is one of my favorites, but I think it was almost too smooth for this medium. And I had tried, what was the brand? I think Canson watercolor paper, which I'm not a huge fan of. I had bought a pad of it on sale from Michaels not long ago. I used to have some, and I used it up. I don't know if it's changed or if my tastes have just changed, but I wasn't very happy with it. It didn't work as well with this medium as I thought it would. It might work fine with regular watercolor, but with the pencils, it just wasn't doing what I wanted it to do. So I ended up just doing this on my original line drawing, which I normally would never do, but I had this original line drawing scanned in and saved already in case I ever want to reuse it for anything. So right now I'm working on the mermaid and I am just putting in the little details. I am trying to make the color scheme look as though she's underwater. And I have all kinds of coral and fun little things that I put in. And none of this is going to be very accurate because I literally did this with no reference. This was just something I had sketched out of my head. So sizing and things like that are definitely not accurate. The things that are under the water may not even actually exist in real life. I have fish and a jellyfish and things like that. So those things exist. But as far as like the coral and the seaweed and things like that, I really don't know how accurate it is, but to me it worked well. And I really like how this breaks down. In some places it was a little bit grainy, but the watercolor pencils break down really well with water. I'm finding that they are not as vibrant as the ink tents, and I've been working with ink tents quite a lot lately, as far as illustrative pieces go. And so I had to get used to that, and I also had to get used to remembering the fact that these watercolor pencils will lift more, obviously, than the Derwent ink tents do, because ink tents are made of ink, so they don't lift after. So that was something I had to get used to, but that was more or less because I haven't worked in watercolor very often lately. I used to walk and work in watercolor all the time, and so I used to be more used to that, but I've been working more with ink and with acrylics lately, so that was more of me just getting used to it. And I'm just going through and putting the details in. I found that it works really well in some parts to just color like the outline, and then I could fill the whole thing in with water, and that worked pretty well. And I'm just going through and getting ready to put some of the details in the water itself. Again, I didn't have a reference, so this probably is not my best piece. But I did have a lot of fun with it. This was really exciting because I just let my imagination go where it wanted to go. And I love doing really detailed pieces. Even if I'm not working in realism, I love doing a lot of detail. And as you can see, I'm just kind of scribbling. I'm not really focused on my pencil strokes because the water will let it, you know, once I add water to it, it will blend out really well. I am curious to try other brands of watercolor pencils, but one reason why I chose this is because, as you know from watching my other videos, I am part of the Colored Pencil Society of America, and they had tested these pencils, and I don't know if they tested them wet, but I know that they tested them at least dry, and as far as light fast testing goes, and I really liked the amount of light fast pencils that were in this. Again, I don't know if the testing was just wet or dry or both, but obviously if they're not light fast when they're dry, they're definitely not going to be light fast after they've been wetted, so I went on that. And for the price, you really can't beat it. I got a great deal on these. I can't remember how much I spent, but there was a deal on Amazon a while back. I think I got them for like the whole set for like $100 or something. It was a great deal anyway. So I couldn't resist. As far as the amount, I can't remember how many pencils I had to take out that weren't light fast. But as far as like pricing goes and compared to some of the other watercolor pencils that they tested, these actually had quite a few light fast pencils compared to some of the other brands. And all that information can be provided to you if you ever decide to join the Colored Pencil Society of America. I am not sponsored by them in any way, but I can tell you that their light fast ratings alone are a lifesaver, and it's worth the money to be part of that just so you can have that testing. It's worry-free as far as I'm concerned, because anytime I get a new set of colored pencils or watercolor pencils, I just check the chart and I weed out the ones that aren't as light fast, and then I can go about my artwork and not have to worry as much. I may still try to spray this with a UV protective spray, but I haven't decided yet. I don't want to like get too close to it with the spray because I don't want it to splatter and cause any issues as far as moving the pigment around, because it is a water-based product. But I have used some spray on watercolors in the past and it hasn't been too bad. So now I'm just adding in more layers in the water with my darker pencils. And going through, and there's a little sea turtle down there that I'm working on. I have to apologize for the angle of this. It's not the best angle. I am still trying to figure out a good way to set up my camera to do time lapses in my studio, which is one reason why you don't see a whole lot of time lapses from me. I will get it figured out eventually, and you will be able to see more time lapses. But for now, it's kind of a weird angle. So I'm just going through, you see this brush is a really old, damaged, what is it? I want to say synthetic hog hair or something. It's like some synthetic brush anyways that you keep seeing me use. It's all rounded over. The one that I'm using right there is a Simply Simmons, but the other one, I can't remember the brand of it, and it is so old, and I think I chopped some of the bristles off. So I use that because it's the bristles aren't as long, and I have quite a bit of control as far as when I'm blending around things, and it works really well. So the moral of that story is to keep your damaged brushes because you might be able to do special effects with them that you wouldn't necessarily be able to use. I call it a stub brush. I have a bunch of what I call stub brushes, where the bristles are like almost down to nothing, just enough to hold water, but not so much that your bristles are going to be flopping around, and it just gives me a lot of control. So I keep a lot of my damaged brushes because I can get different effects with those that I couldn't get otherwise with a regular brush. And I don't tend to spend a lot of money on my brushes anyways, so because I end up damaging them. But I can tell you, even cheaper brushes can last a really long time. My favorite all-time favorite brush is a fan brush that I have had since I was literally 14 years old. And it definitely has seen better days, but that's probably my favorite art supply because it's probably the oldest brush that I have right now. And I don't know as though I'll ever get rid of it. And it still works, so there's a benefit to keeping your damaged brushes anyways, is what I'm saying. So now I'm just going in with some of the details in the underground. I wanted this piece to be fun and whimsical in the fact that you can see above ground and below ground. And in this little below ground scenery, there's actually a little mouse in there. It's hard to see from here. There's a cave in there, and there's stairs that come down from the doorway from the tree. And you can see a kitchen and a bathroom and a living room, and the little mouse is sitting in his armchair watching TV. Kind of random, but I just thought it would be fun to throw him in there. I think that the thing that excites me about this is that it's something that I would have liked as a kid. So I really have always liked these whimsical pictures that you can find all these fun little stories in and fun little details in. And so I had a lot of fun doing this one because it's something, like I said, that I would have liked as a kid, and I think kids might like seeing. And then you just look and you find all these little details. And when I do illustration, I like to do things that have a bunch of detail in them. Of course, when I do realism, I like a lot of detail too. So I guess no matter what kind of artwork I'm doing, I really like to have fun little details. So I'm just laying in color, and as you can see, like I said before, I'm just scribbling. And when I bring water in, it's going to bring it all together. And I'm doing a few different colored browns. I wanted it to be a warm brown for a base, and then I'm going to go over it with a darker brown. And I also go over it later on with some blue from some of the colors from the ocean to tone it down so it kind of looks like it's under the sea. The only part that I didn't do that with was the scenery with a mouse in it, because I kind of wanted that to be like a window. So I didn't glaze that with blue, and it kind of stands out a little bit more. Again, I'm just going in with the details. I'm using some grays for some of the shadowing and for the stairs and some of the rocks that you can kind of see sticking under the ground. And I probably could have done more layers. I ended up doing this whole scene other than the line drawing, because the line drawing, like I said, was done last fall, but I ended up coloring this whole scene in one sitting. Now, normally, if it was regular colored pencils, that would take me a few days. So that's the benefit to this. It's not as vibrant necessarily because it is watercolor, but you could do more layers and get it darker. But it's so much quicker than working in regular colored pencil. And it definitely served its purpose for what I wanted here, which was an illustration. And I do end up going over it later on with my pigment liners and my pit pens because, like I said, I wanted it to be illustrative. So in some ways, I wasn't paying it too close of attention to getting my details dark enough because I knew I was going to be outlining later. But I think that this would be, this medium would still work really well for realism, and I want to try a realistic piece at some point with this medium. So I'm not somebody who, when I do testing, I don't generally do things like swatches and stuff. I do sometimes, and I might swatch these out and water them down to do my own light fast testing just to see, because like I said, I'm not sure if the light fast results were them wet or with them dry. So I might do my own light fast testing on these. But I don't always do swatches. I'm somebody who likes to, in order to get the feel for a medium, I like to do an actual finished piece with them. So that's why I'm doing it this way. And I do like the watercolor look. I think it's a really pretty look. So you can definitely get that with these. Like I said, in some instances, there might be a little bit of grain, but it does break down really well with water. And I don't have any other pencils to compare them to. I haven't used watercolor pencils since I was a teenager. And I can't find any of my old watercolor pencils. I think I found like two or three that were Koei Noir watercolor pencils that I had left over. And a couple of Kimberly watercolor pencils. And I haven't... There's not enough of them left for me to do any pieces with those. So I don't really have much to compare it to that I've done for anything that I've done recently other than the ink tents. And like I said, the ink tents are obviously a little bit more vibrant and they don't lift after. But I think I love them both for different reasons. And I do have another piece planned that's going to be similar in theme to this. It probably will be a while before I do it because I'm really aching to get back to my realism. But I think on that one, I might use the ink tents just because of the kind of colors that I want to use and the vibrancy that I want. But I think it will still come out looking similar enough, but it will be less muted. And I'm just going through now with my pit pens and outlining the details and things like that. Have you tried these pencils before? If so, comment below and tell me what you think of them. I really like them, and I'll definitely be using them a lot more in my artwork. I may even use them to do underpaintings for my other colored pencil work to speed things up a bit. And I would like to try the Faber-Castell watercolor pencils as well. I have to apologize. You probably hear my chihuahua barking in the background. He tends to do that in the most inopportune times. He's a grumpy old man, but I love him anyway. So again, I'm just going through and darkening the water again. So you can definitely layer over it. I usually let it dry first, and then I go back in with my pencil, layer over it, and keep going. Let that dry, and then do it all over again if I want darker. And as long as when you go in with your second layer, you're not getting, you don't add too much water, and you don't try to, if you don't scrub too hard with your brush, it shouldn't lift too bad. Now I'm going through with my white pencil. I've waited for it to dry, and I'm going through with my white watercolor pencil and just freshening up some of the highlights in the water. I'm just going through it and doing touch-ups. So this is my final piece. I hope that you like it. I will definitely be doing more with this medium. Tell me what you think in the comments below about these pencils, and have a great day. Bye!